Hi guys, I'm Dee Harris. Welcome to another episode of Hangin' Out With Dee. And today we have a really exciting topic that we're talking about. We're going to be discussing why bad things happen to good people. I'll be hanging out with Diane Herlihy and a really cool panel. And then we'll also have an award-winning singer at the end. Let's check out who's in our panel. We've got Alexa Servo-Didio. She is psychotherapist and author of Finding Your Peace Within the Chaos. We have Cynthia Quintanal. She's a multidimensional healer and Reiki master and musician. And we have senior pastor of New Hope Baptist Church, Pastor Leroy Parker. So we're really going to have a lot of fun later on. What's up, Diane?
How are you?
Really great. Thank you for having me. Thank you for coming on with us to share your story.
Glad to be here.
Yeah.
Hopefully I can help somebody today.
Yes, absolutely.
Yep.
So you're a good person.
I'd like to think I am. I try to be.
And there's some ugly stuff that you've been through.
Yeah, it's, you know, people have had it worse than me. Some people have had it better than I have. But, you know, I just want to let people know that no matter what they're going through in life, you know, with a little perseverance, strength, and hope and faith, that you can get through anything. And a good sense of humor, too.
Hello.
Absolutely.
That's right. That's
my
your
sense
first
of humor kept me through everything, yes. Absolutely.
So let's start with your childhood. It was a little tough. Talk about that.
Yeah. It was emotionally tough. I was born and raised in an alcoholic family. My father was a functioning alcoholic, held a great job, went to work in a three-piece suit every day. Mm-hmm. Both my parents, actually, were children of alcoholics. So there are some issues that are associated with that. And probably for the first 6 years of my life, I felt loved and great. And around age seven, my dad's drinking took off. Mm-hmm. And I suffered terribly with hypochondria. So I think I internalized a lot of what was going on.
Explain to our audience, you know, we have people all over
the world. What hypochondria is?
What is hypochondria?
Well, it's like the diseases of the month club. You always think you're dying from something. Like, I think I was around 8 years of age, and I wanted my mother to bring me to get a scan on my head because I thought I had a brain tumor. Mm. And most normally, eight-year-olds don't think about brain tumors.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I was internalizing, I guess, a lot of what went on.
Yeah.
I mean, it wasn't like a typical, there was no major arguing or hitting or abuse on any of my parents' parts, but you could just tell that there was a subtle undertone that something wasn't right. I remember one time as a child being in bed with my grandmother and just getting the pins and needles throughout my whole face and body, and I said, Grandma, I feel like I'm going to die.
Yeah.
Now, this isn't something that's normal, you know, for children, so I must have been, you know, internalizing that.
A lot of stress.
Yeah, absolutely, and I was very shy. People who know me today can't believe I was ever shy. You know, they say that that's just unbelievable. But then I went into preteens, and I guess I was around 15, and my father came home one day, and he said he didn't know if he loved us. He didn't know if he loved my mom. He didn't know if he loved anybody. All he knew was that he was an alcoholic and that he wanted to leave. And I went from like loving and adoring my dad.
Mm-hmm.
He had coached my softball teams and done all this stuff to just wanting him out of the house. You know, I don't want to use hate because it's a very strong word, but I really just didn't like him at that point.
Of course.
And basically at that point I went from being like an A-plus student to just failing my best subject, which was math, in about 11th grade. You know, and thankfully at that point I picked myself up, but you know, I turned to alcohol. You know, I got the Irish gene in me too.
Yes.
I tend to like that, but I had turned to that a little bit, and I started changing the people I hung out with. So all the good solid friends I had.
You changed.
I just changed. I just was looking to avoid and to run, basically.
Fast forward, you got married.
Yeah, so basically coming from that type of environment, right, I looked for dysfunctional men and or challenges and everything. So I met a man and I just got involved in a very toxic relationship. There was some great points to it. Obviously, I wouldn't have married him, but the dynamics and the interpersonal were not good.
Yeah.
I accepted a lot of behaviors that were inappropriate in terms of how I was spoken to, how I was treated, and I eventually got the courage to get out of it. And I didn't know how I was going to move on. We had bought a beautiful home, and I wanted to have children, but I knew I was repeating behaviors of the past.
Absolutely.
And I felt that I deserved something more.
Absolutely.
You know? Somewhere I got the courage to leave, but at that point, I started to destroy myself.
Mm-hmm.
And I just drank. I turned to drinking and to alcohol, and it was a tough couple of years, you know, being on my own. I had to meet new people, and really for 2 years, I just had my head in the clouds. And ironically enough, I shouldn't have even been thinking of the online dating thing at that point, but somehow I met this man, And he had something that I wanted. And what he had was like a peace and serenity about him. And he was writing back and forth to me. I eventually did meet him. But, you know, he really gave me the gift of sobriety. And I believe it was my dad, who's now in heaven, who kept saying to me I had a problem with drinking. I think if he couldn't get to me here, he sent somebody to get me. And, you know, I really thought about it. And I said, well, how would I hide my drinking? And, you know, what's interesting is that alcohol, people think, you know, alcoholics have to be Bowery bums. And that's so not the case. Mm-hmm. You know, there were times you couldn't pay me to pick up a drink. I was probably more of like a binge drinker, but in any event, I had to address my drinking, and I had a situation that prompted me to do so. And by the grace of God, May 31st, 14 years, I'll be sober.
Hello.
So,
talk about the other thing that happened. So first it was divorce, and then you had cancer.
Yeah, so basically what happened was I worked on the whole sobriety thing. I had taken someone, I had helped several people, and at one point I was experiencing discomfort, and I had a lesion that was checked out by six doctors and a biopsy, and they told me I had eczema. And five months later, I went to another doctor. I had to fly down to Annapolis, Maryland, because nobody around here could see me. And he said, I think you have invasive squamous cell carcinoma. And it was located in you know, the woman area. And it was actually the result of an autoimmune condition I have called lichen sclerosis that can have potentially the same effects that the sun has on you, where it could damage the skin.
Yeah.
And so he tested me, and he said it was invasive, so I had to go for surgery. I went down to Memorial Sloan Kettering. I didn't know at that point if I had this throughout my whole body, because here I'm thinking it was at least 10, 11 months, you know, had gone by.
Where you thought it was eczema and this was cancer.
Absolutely, yeah.
Oh my goodness.
So that's when I picked up, I went on the internet, and I have this Bible verse that I absolutely love. It's by Mark 10:27, with God all things are possible, and that happens to be my birthday. And there's another one by him, 9:23, the same thing, and that's my sister's birthday.
Oh.
So, you know, it was just
another high five.
Yeah, there we go. So it was just the irony that I would go on the internet.
Yes.
And basically what I did during that time was I hit my knees in prayer. I was always very spiritual in nature and had a connection with God, but I just said, I don't know how this is possible. Mm-hmm. And I said daily affirmations. I read about 12 different Bible verses, daily affirmations of I am, you know, whatever, a cancer-free, I am lichen sclerosis-free, whatever it was. And
that's
then I would command, you know, God will move mountains for us, but you got to bring the pail and the shovel and do some of the work.
Yes.
So,
I love that.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
So I would command the bad things to leave my life, you know. I would say, cancer, I command you leave my body. I have no room for you in my life. I have too much work to do for the Lord. You know, and I did things like that. Well, I wound up going through a second surgery because I wasn't healed. It was 10 months later. I was not healed. And I said to the doc, what's going on? He goes, we'll give it another month. And I said to them, listen, I said, why can't we do it now? Turns out it was cancer again. I had to go for a second operation. After that, I said, these guys, I'm afraid they don't know what they're working with. I flew to MD Anderson in Texas, and I came back by the grace of God and found a wonderful doctor who not only handled the vulva cancer, but she's very, very abreast of lichen sclerosis.
Yeah.
And she works with that, and like I said, by the grace
of
God. And she actually did my surgery in 5.5-inch heels. I couldn't believe it.
I love that.
So
what's her name again?
Dr. Elizabeth Pointer. She's on Park Avenue in New York City.
Dr. Elizabeth, you rock.
Yeah, she's my angel.
And then I want to talk quickly. We have like 30 seconds. You had a friend or someone you thought was a friend who...
Yes.
Who defrauded you. We won't get into it, but you have a giant binder there of all the stuff that you went through legally with her.
I did. I can't even hold up.
It's very heavy.
It's huge, but it's a 5.5-inch binder, and it shows all the deception that I actually went through.
And stuff that you had to present to the police.
Absolutely.
And all this stuff. All right, guys, it's time for Say What? All right, guys, welcome back to Say What? You know that this is a segment of the show where we have our experts talk to us on a specific topic. And today, like I told you earlier, we're talking about why do bad things happen to good people. We're going to start with our psychotherapist, Alexa. Tell us, what do you think about that?
Yes, well, I also, with my clients, I like to focus on is that it's not really about, you know, bad things happening to good people. Sometimes there's things that are in our control and some things that are out of control. And first, I would like to start off to commend you on your resilience and on your strength. It's, you're really an amazing, amazing person.
Thank you.
And I think so many times people get caught up in and get stuck in the thought of, what did I do, what's wrong, what happened? I think it's really about growth, and it's really about how fast we can recover from it, and also focusing on, were there any type of patterns, and what were the different lessons that we could learn through this? And because sometimes when we focus on, you know, was it me, what happened, we really don't look at the bigger picture. And I think it's not about guilt. I don't think guilt should ever be in here, or feeling bad about yourself. Yeah. It's really about healing and growth and moving forward.
I love that. I love that. Cynthia, what do you have to say?
I'm in total agreement with that. And you know, one of the things that I see often in my practice is these family dynamics and lineages that carry forward a lot of these tragic stories, you know, the stories of alcoholism, the stories of poverty. And, you know, I just want to commend you for your courage and your ability and your strength to rise above it. And you know, we can't be alive and not have some sort of suffering. You know, that's just part of being on the planet in a human body. And I believe that, you know, it's all brine for us to polish our shiny souls. You know, it's what makes us who we are. You know, as we look back on our life, right? It, certain things that I perceived as bad or not good in my life actually took me to the next level in my life and propelled me forward. I wouldn't be who I am today without the struggles that I have seen. And so, you know, that's sort of how I look at it. And you know, what I see in my clientele as they come through my door and they tell their stories, you know, one of the things that we do is we map out a whole life story. And I say, you know, well, look at how you overcame this, and, you know, what can we do to shift perhaps the family dynamic of this, you know, like we go through a whole family
history.
You
literally like map it out visually.
Visually,
yeah, yes. I like that.
Yeah, and then we talk about it and say, you know, and oftentimes they'll go, oh, I forgot about that, you know. So there's that. And then there's the aspect of, you know, faith, okay? So like a lot of times these hardships literally bring us to our knees and remind us that there's more beyond this life, that to look at the big picture is to know that this isn't the end here, right? So it's a development, let's say, of our soul and what's beyond. So don't fall for the picture, kind of.
I love that.
You know, things might look bad, but don't look at it that way. Look at it as, you know, I am growing my soul.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
Yeah.
Pastor.
Let me commend you first for your courage and just your faith to come forth and talk about your story. Though all of us have a story, and I'm reminded of Mary and Martha, whose brother who's sick. And they sent for Jesus, and Jesus did not come, and Lazarus died. Martha goes to him and said, why didn't you come? Why didn't you show up? He said, but this was done that I might get glory. And I think your story is a reminder of Jeremiah 29 and 11. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord, thoughts of good and not evil, and to give you an expected end. So we don't plan our story with sickness. We don't plan our story with divorce. We don't plan our story with whatever we experience. But a part of the story is God's story. And that God has a greater story for you. And that he will use you as a testimony and a testament of what it means to endure and still keep your faith. Because while you're enduring, it is creating depth. And the depth is, my faith is encouraged, my faith is strengthened, so that I can become the mouthpiece for others who are in my situation, mm-hmm. who yes. perhaps don't see it as I see it, mm-hmm. but my faith is never wavered because God is still in control.
Yeah.
God have never lost control. Oh. Even though the situations are out of control, God is always in control.
Oh my goodness.
That's great. Thank you.
Oh my God.
I definitely feel that, you know, because I was told, I had shared some of my emotions and on my Facebook page and everything. Folks said to me, you're so inspirational. And I know that's not me. I know that was God using me, you know, to get the message out to other people.
Absolutely. So don't be ashamed to share your story. Because your story becomes the salvation for someone else.
Yes.
How suffering doesn't have to kill you, take you out, but it gives you a proper perspective of who's in charge of it, mm-hmm. and He knows when it's time to take us out of it. And when He takes us out of it, He gives us another platform to be a witness for Him.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Yep. No,
I strongly believe it. Can I show that?
Yes, tell them the story.
Can I?
Story,
yeah. I had a situation for those that wonder, you know, some people say, you know, they pray and nothing happens. They pray and nothing happens. Well, I just have to share this because this is a testament. I was up in Lake George at one point, and it was on the strip, and there was a store in front of me. It was a pocketbook store. It's called Handbag Heaven. And anything that ends in a hole, I thought, that's me. So I said, I have to run in and look at the pocketbooks. And it was, the store was maybe a little smaller than the size of the studio, and all the bags were in sideways, so you couldn't see what was on the front of the bags. So I said to the owner, I says, oh, I want to see that one. He goes, come around the counter and take the bag out. So I pulled the bag out like this. And as Dee had mentioned before we were talking, my favorite Bible verse is Mark 10:27, with God all things are possible. Mm-hmm. So I have camouflage pants, and I said, wow, this would go really nice with it. All of a sudden I look at the bag here, and it says, with God all things are possible. And I'm looking around like, what's going on? You know, is this a joke or what? And I said to the guy, oh my God, I want it in like 6 different colors. And he said to me, because we were on a first name basis now because of how many bags I had in front of me. And he goes, Diane, he goes, I never ordered the pocketbook.
He never ordered
it. He said, I just opened up, because, you know, he gets all these big shipments in and bags and big plastic bags. He never, ever ordered this. Now, what are the odds? I mean,
are the chances?
Yeah. I mean, this to me was God showing me that
Absolutely.
He was there. So, you know, when I do go through tough times or other people have, I brought my pocketbook to their home and said, you just can't make this up. You know, and so that's why I brought it here today, because this to me was a very powerful message that He is there.
Absolutely.
And that I just have to trust Him and turn my will over to Him. And I don't always like it, I'll be honest, right. But, you know, he knows what's best for me. And I think you had mentioned something before, you know, I also go by rejection as God's protection. Mm. So if something doesn't work out, you know, it's taken me a long time to realize that, but I do realize that there is something better in store for me.
Yes.
Yes.
You know,
right.
And that's if I can convey that message to other folks as well. If you don't get the job you want, if the relationship doesn't work out,
Absolutely.
You know, your plans for the day, you're running a half hour late, look at what happened on September 11th. Some of those people were late getting in, and their lives may have been saved because of it. So,
right.
you know, I truly believe it all works out the way
Absolutely.
It's supposed to.
That's beautiful.
Thank you.
That's beautiful. Alexa.
Yes, and I find by what you're doing is so inspirational, and also giving back from what you've learned and through your pain, having the strength and the wisdom to be able to give back to the community, share hope with someone else. Because, you know, so many times when we're in the darkness, mm-hmm. we're alone, we feel isolated, we feel like nobody understands us or hears us. But by telling your story, you really have, someone hits home with someone to say, wow, I'm not the only one. I think that is it's such a blessing and it's such, you know, God's work and what you're doing. And I'd also would like to present you with my book, Finding Your Peace Within the Chaos. I find that you're a true example of finding
you
your peace
in someone who
chaos.
Has found some peace in her in the chaos.
It's my honor to give it to you.
Thank you so much.
That's so beautiful.
You know, just a quick thing to what you said. I had to go for my third surgery where they had to do a second sentinel node biopsy to make sure they got everything. And I had two choices. I could have curled up in a ball the night before and just rocked back and forth nervous. Instead, I was out dancing.
You did?
I was smiling and I was dancing and I said, God, it's in your hands, but I'm going to go out and I'm going to enjoy this.
Yes.
And that's what I did. So I believe it's all in your attitude, my sense of humor, my positive attitude, and my faith. I like this too. Somebody was telling me you could have a glass of dirty water, and if you keep pouring clean water in the glass, eventually it's going to be clean.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're going through the tough times, you have to keep replenishing yourself with the positive.
and keep, you know, reinforcing. So I really look forward to reading this. Thank you so
That's
much.
That's beautiful. Welcome. Anybody has anything else that they want to say? Final words to our global audience, Pastor.
No, I say don't allow struggles or situations in your life, and you just said it, to define who you are, mm-hmm. but you become the determining factor of how you define it.
Yes.
Because I can't allow it to become a part of my existence of who I am, or I realize that this is a part of the journey that I am on, but it doesn't have to become who I am.
Mm-hmm.
So from an existential perspective, even though I'm going through it, it's never become a part of me where I'm having a pity party about what I'm going through,
mm-hmm.
but rather, okay, God, you're in control. I don't understand it, but I trust what mm-hmm. you're doing. Mm-hmm. So I just say to the listening audience, continue to trust God, knowing that God's plan, God has a plan, and he's working that plan out
mm-hmm.
day by day.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. Thank
Amen.
You. That's beautiful.
That. Yeah.
All right, guys. It's time for music. We're going to be having the beautiful, beautiful sounds of recording artist, award-winning recording artist, Don Tallman, right after this. Okay, so we're going to hear the beautiful music of Don Tallman, award-winning recording artist. Tell us what inspired you to write the song for me.
This song came from a really, really dark place in my life at the time, and I just realized that I had a choice to be in that rut or to choose happiness. So this song is really about me choosing happiness and letting people know that you do have a choice mm-hmm. and you can choose happiness.
All right, I'll step off while you sing.
Thank you. Some people live their lives in a masquerade, never knowing who they're gonna be from day to day. But I've known since I was a girl that I am a queen. With every step that I choose to take, that's who I'm gonna be. I choose to be happy. You can be here, who you want to. I choose to be happy. Yeah. Everybody, be yourself. There's only one you. Your heart will know everywhere it goes if you're not being true. I believe that happiness resides in your heart. A higher love does exist and will always be a part of my life. You can be whatever you wanna be. I choose to be happy. I made a decision, yeah, to be H-A-P-P-Y, so happy. But for me, I choose to be happy, yeah, yeah. No matter what it looks like, no matter how you feel, you can choose to be happy. Yes, for me, I choose to put a smile on my face. Oh, oh, you can be whatever you wanna be. Yes, but for me,
like these words right here. You gotta live your life. You gotta laugh out loud. You gotta sing your song. You gotta love. Come on and dance. Come on and dance with me. You gotta look and know it's gonna be alright. You gotta live your life. You gotta laugh. You gotta sing. You gotta love. Come on and dance. Come on and dance with me. You gotta know it's gonna be alright. You gotta live. You gotta laugh. You gotta sing. And you gotta love, yeah. No matter what it looks like, no matter how you feel, stick your head up, hold your head high, and be happy, yeah, yeah. Oh, H-A-P-P-Y, H-A-P-P-Y.
Much.
Thank you.
All right, guys. One love, everyone. One love. See you next week. Bye.